first three chapters are a prayer, a blessing, and a thanksgiving. They're just this long, extended, but there's so much that we glean from these first three chapters. So let's go to Ephesians chapter 4, and I'm going to be in the first 16 verses for a few weeks, but today, mainly I want to talk about the first two verses. And during the week, during the next couple weeks, maybe you can spend some time in 1 through 16 just in your daily Bible reading. Of course, we have Palm Sunday and Easter that are going to come in and kind of interrupt our Ephesians study. But I'm going to get started today. These first 16 chapters, and I told you this was coming because Paul had alluded to unity in the blessing and thanksgiving. Now we're going to really talk about unity in the body of Christ. Paul says, "I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness and patience, bearing with one another in love." So you can see on the back of the bulletin today, I'm going to talk about this humility and gentleness and patience and this tolerant love that he's talking about. Let me kind of tell you what's happening here as we shift from chapter 3 into chapter 4. Of course, there was no chapter numbers and verses in Paul's letter. It just would have been a shift to the main body of his letter. And so up to this point, halfway through the letter, the readers of the letters, they've not been asked to do anything except to remember their past, how they were alienated or separated from Jesus, and that they had been presently accepted by Jesus. You go back to chapter 2, verse 11, and that's where Paul specifically said it. The former way you were, separated from God, but now through Jesus have been united. So, for three chapters, all we have seen is a reminder of God's goodness. Okay? Over and over. And how incredible, how marvelous our salvation is. And we've praised that with Paul. Now, with all the force, and really the word urge, I don't think carries the weight of what Paul's trying to say here. He's urging you. So with all the force that is possible with the language, the readers are now implored to live a life that's worthy of their calling. Okay, verse 1. "I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling from which you have been called." Okay? So now, all of a sudden, Paul is going to get to the meat, really, of the letter. This letter to the Ephesians, as I've said over and over, is about transformation and about change. Okay? Can't be transformed without changing. You can't change if you're not transformed. Okay? And we get so much of what we understand about being the body of Christ from this letter. And now he's blessed and given thanksgiving and prayed for half his letter. Now he's going to get to really the meat of why he's writing the Ephesian Christians. So, very basically, applying this passage and applying this letter, especially these next three chapters that we're going to study, is about accepting a challenge. About accepting a challenge to live a life worthy of our calling. Okay? When we get through with this letter, that's really where everyone should be. Do I accept this challenge? Everyone likes a good challenge, right? Most people like a good challenge, to be challenged to do something. Some may say, no, I don't. I don't like to be challenged. But this letter is going to challenge us. Okay? I've noticed already Janelle is paying particular attention to me this morning. She helped me a lot last week during my sermon, and she's probably wondering, is he going to keep calling on me? You helped me a lot last week during my sermon. I appreciate that. Your answers were all correct, or exactly the way I hoped you would answer. So it was perfect. They thought we planned it, I'm sure, you know. But we did it, did we? So very often I find that Christianity is presented as though We don't have to do anything. Right? Just believe, then that's it. Just, you don't have to do anything else. I think that's often the way Christianity is presented to us. And a lot of times I hear people place such an emphasis on how weak poor Christians are. Okay? How we can do nothing. We're so weak. We're really unable to do anything that's really profitable. And everything we do necessitates God doing something through us. That, to the point that I think they kind of lead us to believe that there's really no human responsibility when it comes to Christianity. Okay? And maybe you're thinking, well, that, yeah, I kind of feel like I've heard that too. The New Testament in the Bible never, ever, ever gives this impression. It never does. Now, I don't want to rehash it and talk about it, how we're born dead in our trespasses and unable to move towards salvation. Yes, those things are all true. But I think we take that and we take it over into our new life in Christ and act like we still can't do anything. We're born dead, unable to do anything. But what Paul's trying to say, and he says it so much better in Colossians, but he says it here too, is, wait a minute, you're not dead anymore, Christian. It's time for you to begin to live. Right? But I won't go into it again. We talk about this often. A lot of Christians put that off into eternity somewhere. Yeah, I'm going to get real busy enjoying my life in Christ when I die and go to heaven. It's not what Paul's talking about. So, the New Testament never really gives this impression. Human responsibility, yes, is wedded to God's action. It's married to it. It is tied to it, okay? It's inseparable. But we have a responsibility. We are responsible as Christians. We must expect something of ourselves, okay? We must expect something of each other in this walk in Christ. What Paul's saying, if God's salvation is so good, no one had any trouble agreeing with Paul for the first three chapters. We were giving thanksgiving with him. We were praying with him. We were being blessed with him. And now Paul's saying, if it's so good and you agree with me, then start living it. And start living out this salvation. So what does that require? Well, what we're going to see in these next three chapters is it really requires an act of our will. Okay? An act of our will and a determination to follow through. Okay? People always want to know, you know, we talk about God's sovereignty so much, they always want to say, but I see God, see our will in this too. Yeah, here's a good spot to show you. Here's a good spot. God is expecting something of our will. God is expecting something of our follow-through. Okay? I hope you've never been in this situation. Have you ever been in a situation when you were growing up, maybe with your parents, or maybe when you got into school, or maybe when you got into your job, or your second job, or your third job, whatever it may be, and people kept saying, you know what? You're a nice enough person, and you're a great guy, but you just don't follow through. You just don't have any follow through. Hope that's not happened to anyone, but that's a terrible attribute to have, is someone who doesn't follow through. Or maybe you've known someone, and they say, they're always got a lot of ideas. They say, I'm going to do this and this and this, but they never follow through. Is that not aggravating? Right? Okay, so I won't keep pushing that. But what I'm trying to show us is that we say we believe. We say we're a Christian. And what Paul is telling Ephesians is, so follow through with it. You say you're a Christian. You say you believe. You say you trust Christ. Now, where's the follow through? Okay? Because Christianity is not just a belief. It's a faith. But it's a practice. It's a faith that we practice. That what you know, I talk about this, and it'll come up again in this message. Last week, it's as much about our heart, our head, and our hands. It's an equal thing. If you have no hands to your Christianity, what good is it? If it's all heart and no head, then it's just all emotion. If it's all head and no heart, then there's no emotion, right? So it's all of these things, and these come out so well in Ephesians. It's about our heart. It's about our head. It's about our hands. And so I like this metaphor then to walk in verse 2. In verse 1. I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of your calling. Some of your Bibles have to live. And what your translators have done, they've said, well, maybe people aren't understanding what it means to walk. And it's really not literally to walk. It's to live. And so they changed the word from the Greek. But to walk, to live according to your calling, a manner worthy of your calling. So, what does that suggest? To walk according to your calling. Well, to me, it sounds like it's something that we control. It's a controlled thing. It's an enduring thing. It's a directed thing. It's not something that's hectic or aimless. Okay? I hope you don't live a hectic life, an aimless life, just wandering around. I mean, I hope you don't get up in the morning and say, I don't know what's going to happen today, but I'm heading out. Right? What kind of life is that? Some people may live that kind of life. Or you may end up living your life that way. You don't mean to when you start out, but that's no kind of life to live. We need a plan. We need a plan of action, right? Gertrude, do you have a plan of action for you? Yeah, I know you do. I know you're very detailed. So, I'm calling names, and I shouldn't be doing that, because then I'm going to leave somebody out. So this faith, this Christianity, is something that is not hectic. It's not aimless. It's not. Amber tried to explain that in when she talked about this reckless kind of love that Christ has. So, really, and I think what Paul's dealing with in Ephesians is Ephesus. We still deal with today is, you know, short term effort is really of no value. Okay? I know that we have several men in our church that are in the construction, some different types of construction business. And they probably have people that come to work for them. And the first couple days they're like, wow, this guy's a hard worker. But what good is it if he shows up the next Monday and he doesn't want to do anything? That's worth nothing, right? How long does that person last? And so short-term value in our walk, in our faith, is of no value. What is God looking for? A lifetime of faithfulness. This is a lifetime commitment to walk in a manner worthy of your calling. What is that manner? What does that look like? It's a life lived for Jesus. Okay? And so, I don't want to suggest that we can accomplish this by ourselves, and I just want to make that statement. None of this is to suggest that, you know, you get up in the morning, and you think of what you're going to do for Christ, and you say, well, if it's to be, it's up to me. No, that's not entirely true. But I'm not trying to say that. But instead, it's life with God, okay? It's this life in Christ. It's with His help, okay? And it's a life of discipline, and it's a life of effort, right? Are you getting that? It's a life of discipline, and it's a life of effort. Sometimes Christianity is more easy to explain, for me, in athletic terms. Not everybody gets athletic terms, but, you know, before I, you know, got older and got fatter, I was a runner, and I understand what it means to dedicate one's life to running. And you don't, when you're a runner, you don't just get up and run. You don't just get up and run a race. You don't lay around resting until it's time. You work hard and you train. For those people that you see when you turn on the television and the Olympics and such, they've spent their whole life training. It's a lifestyle. And Paul, what did Paul say eventually in his life in Timothy when he meets the Lord? What does he want Timothy to know? everyone to know in the letter that he ran the good race. He never quit, never stopped, okay? It was a lifetime commitment. And so, you know, discipleship is a word I think we understand. I don't know that we do it terribly well, but with discipleship comes discipline. Without discipline, discipleship doesn't exist. And I think that what happens is, and I think this is why Paul uses the metaphor of the family a lot, is because we can see ourselves as children in the family, right? As children of God, I think sometimes we can see ourselves as children in the family. And so most children that I've been around and admit to as a child, remembering when I was a child, if some of you can think back, and when you were a child, was it that you went around all the time thinking, I want to do what I'm supposed to. I want to do what I should. No. You ran around doing what you could get away with, right? Most of the time, you did what you could get away with. And I think a lot of times as Christians, that's what our discipleship looks like. I want to do good, but I'm going to do everything I can get away with and not get into trouble for it. And so this is not living worthy of the call. And so the problem, I think, is, and see if you don't agree with me, to some extent, it's like we have this million-dollar salvation. I don't know if $1 million is enough anymore, because, you know, like our government's spending trillions now. So we have this trillion-dollar salvation, this salvation that is, you know, beyond imagination, but we have like a $100 response to it. Okay? Can you see that picture? Paul's describing this salvation, and it's overwhelming. But we have such a weak response. I mean, I've brought this up before, and I don't want to chase a rabbit, but if you had to give, if you had to pay for your salvation, if all of a sudden God said, I'm changing the plan, and I need you to pay for it, what would you be willing to give up? I mean, what if all of a sudden we had to give up everything to be saved? I just wonder. I'm glad we don't have to face that question. I wonder how many people would say, okay, take it all. I'll walk out of here today with nothing but what I came in with. Take it all. I wonder if a lot of people wouldn't say, maybe I'll just give half just in case. Or maybe I'll give two-thirds, whatever. We might come up with some conditions even. But I say that because it seems like we're unimpressed with salvation. We protest back towards God or back towards pastors or back towards the Bible that is anybody really actually able to live this life that the Bible describes? You know, when I've taught on the Sermon on the Mount, I've taught how everyone believes that the Sermon on the Mount is for some future time, because there's no way in the world we could live that way. When Jesus came and said, I'm preaching this sermon, and this is how people in the kingdom should live, yet 2,000 years later, people said, well, we don't know exactly what he was talking about, because this life is impossible to live now in this life, so he must be talking about some future time. No, he's not. When he says, this is how people in the kingdom live, he meant what? This is how people in the kingdom live. When is the kingdom? I guess you can argue that too. Jesus says, in me the kingdom of God has come. And this is how people live in the kingdom. So what does that mean to us when we read Matthew 5, 6, and 7? That means when we read it, that's how we're supposed to live. And that kind of gets to this point I think Paul is beginning to make. And I think people today still protest, can that life actually be lived? Are we capable of living a life worthy of the call? But I'll tell you what, this text isn't worried about either of those things. This text is not worthy about whether you're impressed or not with your salvation. And this text is not worried about whether you think you can live it out or not. Paul doesn't care about either of those two things. This text is concerned only that our saved by our salvation. That the forming of our lives, our lives are shaped by our salvation. So, what Paul would say then is, a right understanding should lead to a right way of living. So when we finish Ephesians, a right understanding of what Paul is saying is in Ephesians should lead us to living the right kind of life, one shaped by our salvation. So you might say, why didn't everybody get that? Why don't we get that? We're in Christ. We're a new creation. Through Christ, we can live out this life worthy of the call. Why do a lot of people start out that way and the process gets aborted? You remember the parable of the soils that Jesus preached, which I think is the most important parable? Remember what happened to the seed that was cast into the rocks or where the soil was in so thin on top of the rocky soil, and what? It shot up real quick, right? But what happened when the sun and the pressures of the world came out? It was done. Now, what good is that plant? It's no good. So the question is, why does that happen? Well, Jesus, I think, explained it. It's the pressures of the world. But I think a lot of it is because a proper understanding of Christianity so often goes through our brain only. It's what our mind, it's what our brain understands. And it never gets to our heart. And never gets to our hands. So much of what people think of Christianity is what they understand in their brain about it. Okay? And their faith is one of just knowledge. Just something that they know. And it's not something that they feel in their heart. Okay? Or that they put to action in their hands. So again, this all comes down to a proper understanding in our hearts, in our head, and in our hands. Our calling, then, it has to be sincere, and it has to be honest, and really, then, it has to get down into the depths of our being. Okay? Now think about this for a moment, because this is very important. A lot of us know things in our head, right, that are good for us or the right thing to do or just the smart thing to do, right? And that's what we always do, right? The good thing, the smart thing, right? All of us, right? We always do the smart thing. Almost all of us in here have at least teenage or adult children. Aren't you glad your kids always do the smart thing? I'm not picking on younger people with no children. You're going to find that out later. You're going to learn this lesson later. Aren't you glad your children never make the mistakes you made when you were young? They listen to you, and they don't do it, what you did wrong, right? Because it didn't work out for you. You tell them, and then they don't do it. I'm not getting any agreement here. I guess I'm the only family. No, it's not that way in my family. In fact, I beat my head on the wall too because my children make the same mistakes I made and they have to pay for it or I have to pay for it, you know, and so it just keeps going on, right? Well, I want you to think about that because our faith is somewhat like that. Okay? We are all born, I'm going to use a word that none of the teachers, my wife's not here, so I won't get in trouble for it. But I will from the parents. And we're all born stupid. Okay? Not a person in here knows any better than to do the wrong thing or the bad thing or the thing that's going to hurt them. No one's born doing good things, doing the smart thing. We're all born with this mental handicap, this mental block called sin. And it controls what? It controls our mind, it controls our heart, it controls our hands. Everything we do is sinful, right? Now, hopefully when you became a Christian, so that's a lot of you, right? A lot of you in here are Christians. Would you agree with me? I hope you would. Did they not tell you If it was me, I know I told you, but most of you became a Christian before I met you. Did someone not tell you that because you are now a Christian, you are a new creation in Christ Jesus? The old you is gone, and now there is a new you in Christ Jesus. And you recorded that in your mind somewhere, right? I pray you did. But I'm telling you, what Paul's trying to say to the Ephesians is, just knowing that is not enough. Just knowing that's not enough. It's got to get down in your heart. It's got to become something that when somebody says, we are saved through Jesus Christ, and you say, amen. Yes, I'm saved. It affects me emotionally. It affects everything I do, my life. I'm excited about that, right? It's not just something I know. It's something that changed me. But then the other thing it does, it's got to affect your hands and your feet. It means that knowing that I'm a new creation in Jesus Christ, I'm a new person, it affects everything I do, everything I touch. And let me just add, when I say hands, I mean those things. It affects my tongue. It affects my mouth. It affects everything I say and do. So it's not just something I know. And not to belittle the knowing part, that's a big part. That's an equal part. But I'm telling you, most people got the knowing part down. So I'm not hitting on that. Most people have the knowledge. I know that I am saved, that I'm a new creation. And so what I say to you today is what Paul said. So do something about it. Live it out. Live a life that is worthy of the calling. Live a life that is worthy of your salvation. And like I said, it's a $1 trillion salvation. It's beyond anything that any of us can afford. And I'm glad. I'm glad that it's that way. I'm glad that God didn't make me give up everything I own to receive salvation. I'm glad He did. He let me keep my livelihood, the things that I own, because maybe I don't know what I would have done. I don't know what I would have done. But all I had to do, all He made me do, was accept the gift of Jesus Christ, what He gave so that I could have salvation. And we can wrap our head around that, and we can understand that, but it has to go down into the depths of who we are. It has to affect our very being. So, you know, really, if somebody says, who are you? We usually say our name, right? I'm Greg. Who are you? I'm Greg. And then we add some things after, right? And for everybody, it's kind of different. You want me to try it out? Let's see. Gertrude, who are you? Just Gertrude Stewart? But you're a mother or grandmother? Where are you from? Texas? See, that's number two for me, because that's the most important. No. Ryan, who are you?
Father.
Father.
Husband.
Husband. Junior, who are you?
Okay. Father, son, grandpa. Christian.
I'm kind of kidding, but I'm not. And I put people on the spot, so, you know. But you try it. You try asking people who they are. Okay, who are you? And rarely will anybody say, I'm Greg, a follower of Jesus. But I'm telling you, if we get excited enough about this salvation, that's what we'll say. And Janelle's going to go to school money and say, I'm Janelle, a follower of Jesus. I know she's going. So that's what I'm getting to. This is where Paul is beginning in this message. So then, when we get to that point that this salvation affects us down in the deepest part of our being, who we are in Christ, that is the most important thing to Paul. That's what Paul lived his life for. He was Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Look at all his letters. Look what he says about himself. I am a bondservant of Jesus, a slave to Jesus Christ. So then, by a determined act, okay, of our wills, and by God's Holy Spirit, because that's the only way it works out, so then, we live a life, a determined life. So what is that determination? I'm going to live, I'm going to walk worthy of my call. I'm determined to do that. We're born unable to, but in Christ, there's the change. There's the change. We have God's Holy Spirit. And then what happens? We're drawn into this call. Okay? We're drawn into this call. It's a beautiful picture. It's a beautiful picture that Paul's trying to paint for us. We're drawn into this call, and then we're able to receive, and we're able to give grace. Now think about it. That's where I'm going to stop today. I said that didn't fit the outline at all. Well, sometimes that happens. This is what I wanted you to understand today. This is where I wanted us to go from this place today. So, if you don't remember anything that I said, but the part where I said, who are you? Who are you? I want you to begin to think that way. I'm Greg, a follower of Jesus Christ. Tell you what, not a lot of people happy with where we are in our nation right now. Not a lot of people happy. Just do a poll. Just do a poll. You start living as a follower of Jesus Christ, it'll change this community. It'll change this world. It did, Paul. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you for this message. Thank you for the encouragement Paul gives. Though I don't know that it's only encouragement. He's imploring us to let our understanding of our salvation get down into our being. So, Father, that's what I pray for each one here, that it is not just locked in our brains, but it, Father, it just overwhelms us. And it affects everything we say and do and touch and feel. Father, we just are overwhelmed with this incredible salvation. Father, help us to be that then, these vessels that both receive grace and distribute grace. Father, I know Paul's fixing to talk to us about that. It's going to begin with our next message. Father, helping us to understand then what this looks like. What does it look like when we're living, when we're walking a life worthy of our call? I pray that for each one here this morning, a life worthy of the call, worthy of the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ. I pray, Father, just that one thing that is felt here this morning is that we're not alone in it. We have a partner in it. Really, all of our power comes from our partner, your Holy Spirit, living within us. Father, just help us to see the fact that we must be determined as Paul was, to run the race, to stay committed. Father, I pray that for everyone here in your precious